I say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when men rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us alive when their wrath was kindled against us. Then the waters would have overwhelmed us. The stream would have gone over our soul. Then the swollen waters would have gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord, who has not given us as prey to their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird from the snares of the fowlers. The snare is broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Amen. A great truth, a great testimony of the people of Israel, of the natural people of God back then, but also of the people of God at all times. If the Lord was not with us, things would have been very difficult in our life. Being the people of God, children of God, the people of Israel back then, the Church of Jesus Christ now. The truth is that we are living in a spiritual world where there is war, a rough war, a fierce war for the souls of men, especially for the people of God that have come out of Egypt. They have come out of the world, and they have no one to defend them. The people of God, I'm using a human expression here, is without kin and has nobody else in this world. Nobody else except Christ. Nobody else except Almighty God. But if God is not with us, they would have swallowed us up alive when their wrath was kindled against us, when people rose up against us. We wouldn't be able to do anything. Nothing would happen. As lambs in the midst of wolves, God sends us forward, but He is with us. Just think of a lamb among wolves without having the good shepherd with it. Just make a thought. One lamb among many wolves. Not one wolf among a flock. How much harm it may do if the flock doesn't have a shepherd. But think of what will happen to the lamb that doesn't bite, that cannot bark, that doesn't fight or quarrel. It is an absolute weakness because of its nature. This is how God has made the lamb. It doesn't defend itself. It doesn't attack. It is this man who has heavenly protection. Many waters would have swallowed us up, would have overwhelmed us if God was not with us. The overflowing stream, the flood waters, would have covered over our soul if God was not with us. Swollen waters, wild rivers would have gone over our soul and would have drowned us, would have destroyed us if God was not with us. For that reason, a praise comes forth out of the heart of the psalmist, who is one of those who testifies that God was with him. Blessed be the Lord, who has not given us as prey, as bounty to their teeth, and they have not devoured us. And I believe, my dear brethren, that every one of us thinks of his life and of his past as he hears the words of God. Our soul was saved as a bird that had been trapped in the snares of the fowlers. How? The snare was broken, and we have escaped. Someone broke that snare, and now we are free. And in the end, because the Lord is with us, for that reason, our help is in the name of the Lord of hosts, who created the heavens and the earth. Because God is with us, because the Lord is with us, the name of the Lord of hosts in our lips and in our life is almighty. It is a mighty fortress. It is our weapons. It is our strength. It is our salvation. If God... and they were vanquished by the demon-possessed people. There is no power in the name of Jesus Christ in our life unless God is with us. And all things change in our life when God is with us, when God defends us, when God goes before us in our life. He destroys the plans and the works of the devil that are great, all cunning and wicked. He destroys the weapons of the devil that had been prepared against us. And our security, our triumph, is the name of the Lord of hosts when God is with us. But there's one question here that rises in our heart. Is God truly with us? So all these things may apply. When is God with us? Is he always with the people of God? In other words, does this special situation and condition and promise that Christ gave, that I will be with you all the days until the end of the age, is truly God with us, or do we think that God is with us? Because the days that are coming are a lot more difficult. When the Word of God says that in the latter times, evil days will come, we cannot imagine the magnitude of the meaning that is contained in these few words. So it is absolutely necessary that God be with us, because then the name of Jesus Christ is our shield and our sword, and our triumph, and our security. But I repeat the question, which is especially, I'll use an expression here, terrifying, that scares the Christian, that ought to scare the Christian. At this moment that I'm speaking, is God with me? So that all these great things may apply that are described by the psalmist and the Holy Spirit, the Word of God to us. Now that I am speaking and we're listening to the word of God, are you sure, brother, sister, that God is with you? Or are you alone as a lamb among wolves? Or is the good shepherd with you, the Lord of hosts, the King of kings, the Lord of lords? This is a question that torments, that if we just pass it by, we just lose the fear of God. And whoever loses the fear of God, he loses his mind. Whoever loses the fear of the Lord of hosts, because the beginning of all wisdom is the fear of the Lord, he won't even have the beginning of wisdom. Truly, he'll lose his mind in the end. He walks in his own fantasy and imagination, completely unprotected, and his soul is constantly in serious danger. So the question, my dear brethren, that we must not take lightly, nor superficially, nor as something that is for others, but we must think about it, as the Word of God says, with fear and trembling, work out your own salvation. Let us take it with great seriousness, lest something has happened or something is happening and we have lost our path, which is very easy to happen. Very easy to happen for you to lose your way, for you to lose wisdom and understanding, the man of God, to lose these things. To lose his walk. It is very easy, but also very serious. For that reason, God, and I want us to read this in the book of Zechariah the prophet, chapter 1. Verse 2, it says something. Lord God, the Lord has been very angry with your fathers. Therefore say to them, thus says the Lord of hosts, return to me, says the Lord of hosts, and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. Do not be like your fathers, to whom the former prophets preached, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, turn now from your evil ways and your evil deeds. But they did not hear nor heed me, says the Lord. Your fathers, where are they? And the prophets, do they live forever? Yet surely my words and my statutes, which I commanded my servants the prophets, did they not overtake your fathers? So they turned and said, just as the Lord of hosts determined to do to us, according to our ways and according to our deeds, so he has dealt with us. Sin, deception, iniquity, transgression, the little thing that comes out of a heart that says, doesn't matter, can lead man slowly, slowly into a different path that is not in the paths of the Lord of hosts. The result being that he walks, the man of God walks, steady and stably, but he's lost his path. And you can't tell this in the beginning. God suffers long so that man may return. But as time goes by, the course becomes more and more difficult. And man says, it doesn't matter, this is a trial. And he thinks and he says, it doesn't matter, this is a temptation. It's okay, things will become better. But as this the course unravels, there is no correction because God is not with him. So here, my dear brethren, is why this is so important for us to know. Because years pass by. Young people will get married. The older will have children. The even older are drawing near to the end of their life. How important is it then for God to be with us? How important is it? People say, for cautious reason, they take they stand. How important it is for us to stand with the Word of God before that mirror and examine ourselves, our inner man and our outer man, and especially to ask the Lord. And even more, that we ask one another. My wife, how do you see me? Parents, how do you see me? My children, how do you see us? And to ask from God, request from God, and tell us, teach us, Lord, the things that we do not see. To know the things that we have not understood yet. Help us at this moment, as we hear the Word of God and haven't understood it yet, let us be found in a path. Let us not be found in a path that leads to a dead end. And a path that leads to a wall. Help us, Lord. Help us understand. Because if we do not return to the way of the Lord, to the true God, he will neither return to us. And we will walk on our own. And our road will become all the more desolate, more and more dangerous, and more painful. So today, my dear brethren, today God is calling us to take things under serious account. To leave superficiality, because the Word of God says this, that there is superficial healing. Let us take under serious consideration our personal life, our family life, our church life, and examine and see if we are the way God wants us to be, and we can understand if we are this way. And even if we cannot, God will give us enlightenment. But it is necessary for us to examine. Not the others, which this is also a sin by judging and condemning other people. People regarding whom we have no right, not even to look at them and observe them. But we must examine ourselves and the ones that God has set next to us, upon which God has given us authority. And let us see and discern first if we are walking in the sound doctrine of God. Secondly, if we are living in the church. Do we have truly church practice of the first apostolic church? We are not Christians of Sunday Christians. We are not Christians that just visit the house of God. but we are Christians who dwell in the house of God. It is our house, the house of God. We are not visitors or passerbyers. We have a church conscience, church practice, and church holiness. We continue, we await eagerly every day in the doctrine of the apostles, every Sunday in the breaking of bread, every time in fellowship with one another, and especially in prayers, our personal, our family prayers, and our church prayers. Because we will assume other things, and other things will happen in our life. We will wait for peace and security, and sudden destruction will come, especially in these latter days. That God wants to sanctify His church. And thirdly, if we have the way, the mind frame of the good Christian, the mind frame of the Holy Spirit, if indeed we live according to the Spirit, and we also walk according to the Spirit, if we are not aligned with the world, but we are transformed every day through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit from His Word, if daily our building and our progress is in, it grows in spiritual things, in our personal, in our family, in our church life, we are not the way we were yesterday. We are a lot closer to the Lord, because the Lord says, draw near to me, and then I will draw near to you, having beforehand resisted the devil so that he may leave. We don't play church here. We are a church of God. We don't pretend to be a Christian. We are children of God. For that reason, the fear of God must rule in our heart. And we search, we look at ourselves, examine ourselves. We search out. We cry out and say, Lord, teach us the way that I have to walk in. Do you think I've made a wrong turn? Teach us, Father, to do your will. To do your will. Could it be that we are doing our own will and not your will? Teach us, Lord God. Teach us so that we may glorify you with all our heart, our soul, and our mind, our strength, but especially that we may love you as you want us to love you. Amen.